As they started to climb into the taxi, he changed his mind. He could do that. Schaefer saw that neither of them was as attractive as he'd thought. The man's cheeks and forehead were slightly mottled. The pomade in his black hair was too thick and greasy. The woman was a few pounds heavier than he liked, plumper than she'd looked from a distance in the flattering streetlights. "Off duty," he said, and sped away. Both of them gave him the finger. He stopped for more coffee at a Starbucks on Rhode Island Avenue. Nothing like it. He purchased 3 black coffees and heaped 6 sugars in each. An hour later, he was in Southeast. He hadn't stopped for another fare. Then he saw her, a perfect brown goddess standing right there before him, as if someone had just given him a wonderful present. She was walking by herself, about a block from E Street, moving fast, purposefully. He was instantly high again. He loved the way she moved, the swivel of her long legs, the exactness of her carriage. She had on a light cream suit, a purple silk shirt, high heels. She looked too classy and adult to be going to a club. She was waving her hand at him, signaling. "Taxi," she called. "Taxi, are you free?" He guided the taxi over to the curb, and she took 3 quick, delicate steps towards him. She was wearing shimmery, silken high heels that were just delightful. She was much prettier up close. She was a 9.5 out of 10. The cab door swung open and blocked his view of her for a second. Then he saw that she was carrying flowers, and wondered why. Something special tonight? Well, that was certainly true. The flowers were for her own funeral. "Oh, thank you so much for stopping," she spoke breathlessly as she settled into the taxi. He could tell that she was letting herself relax and feel safe. Her voice was soothing, sweet, down to earth, and real. "At your service," Schaefer turned and smiled at her. "By the way, I'm Death. You're my fantasy for this weekend."
Monday mornings, I usually work the soup kitchen at St. Anthony's in Southeast, where I've been a volunteer for the past 6 years. I do the 7-to-9 shift 3 days a week. That morning I felt restless and uneasy. I was still getting over the Mr. Smith case, which had taken me all over the East Coast and to Europe. Maybe I needed a real vacation, a holiday far away from Washington. As I said my cheery hellos and dished out heaped portions of peanut butter, I allowed myself to think about Christine. I remembered a night about 2 weeks back. I had just finished working a multiple homicide case in Boston. Christine and I stood on the porch in front of her house out in Mitchellville. I was trying to live my life differently, but it's hard to change. I had a saying I really liked: heart leads head. I could smell the flowers in the night air, roses and impatience growing in profusion. I could also smell gardenia passion, a favorite perfume that Christine was wearing that night. She and I had known each other for 1.5 years. We met during a murder investigation that had ended with the death of her husband. Eventually, we began to go out. I was thinking that it had all been leading to this moment on the porch. At least it had in my mind. I had never seen Christine when she didn't look good to me and make me feel lightheaded. She's tall, almost 5'10", and that's nice. She had a smile that could probably light up half the country. That night, she was wearing tight, faded jeans and a white t-shirt knotted around her waist. Her feet were bare. Her nails were dabbed with red polish. Her beautiful brown eyes were shining. I reached out and took her into my arms. And suddenly, everything seemed right with the world. I forgot all about the terrible case I'd just finished. I forgot about the particularly vicious killer known as Mr. Smith. I cupped Christine's sweet, kind face gently in my hands. I like to think that nothing scares me anymore, and many things don't. But I guess the more good things you have in your life, the easier it is to experience fear. Christine felt so precious to me. So, maybe I was scared. Heart leads head. It isn't the way most men act, but I was learning. I love you more than I've ever loved anything in my life, Christine. You help me see and feel things in new ways. I love your smile, your way with people, especially kids, your kindness. I love to hold you like this. I love you more than I could say if I stood here and talked for the rest of the night. I love you so much. Will you marry me, Christine? She didn't answer right away. I felt her pull back just a little, and my heart caught. I looked into her eyes, and what I saw was pain and uncertainty. It nearly broke my heart. "Oh, Alex, Alex," she whispered, and looked as if she might cry. "I can't give you an answer. You were just on another horrible, horrible murder case. I can't take that. You can't deny any of that." I couldn't. It had been a terrifying experience, and I had nearly died. "I won't deny anything you said, but I do love you. I can't deny that either. I'll quit the police force if that's what it takes." "No." A softness came into her eyes. She shook her head back and forth. "That would be all wrong for both of us." We held each other on the porch, and I knew we were in trouble. I didn't know how to resolve it. I had no idea. Maybe if I left the forest, became a full-time therapist again, led a more normal life for Christine and the kids. But could I do that? Could I really quit? "Ask me again," she whispered. "Ask me again sometime." Christine and I dated since that night, and it just felt right, easy, comfortable, and romantic. It always was that way between us. Still, I wondered if our problem could be fixed. Could she be happy with a homicide detective? Could I stop being one? I didn't know. I was brought out of my reverie about Christine by the high-pitched stuttering wail of a siren out on 12th Street, just turning off E. I winced when I saw Samson's black Nissan pull up in front of St. Anthony's. He turned off the siren on his rooftop, but then beeped the car horn, sat on it. I knew he was here for me, probably to take me somewhere I didn't want to go. The horn continued to blare. I walked outside, crossing through the soup kitchen line, and receiving a few jokey jeers. People I had known for a long time accused me of working half a day, or said that if I didn't like the job, could they have it? "What's up?" I called to Samson before I got all the way out to his black sports car. Samson's side window came sliding down. I leaned inside the car. "You forget? It's my day off," I reminded him. "It's Nina Charles," Samson said, in the low, soft voice he used only when he was angry or very serious. He was trying to deaden his facial muscles, to look tough, not emotional, but it wasn't working real well. "Nina's dead, Alex." I shivered involuntarily. I opened the car door and got in. Samson jerked the car away from the curbside fast. The siren came on again, but now I almost welcomed the mournful wail. It numbed me. "What do you know so far?" I asked as we rushed along the intensely bleak streets of Southeast, then crossed the slate-gray Anacostia River. "She was dumped in a row house, 18th and Garnsville. Jerome Thurman is out there with her. Says she's probably been there since the weekend. Some needle pusher found the body." "No clothes or ID, Alex," Samson said. I looked over at him. "So how did they know it was Nina?" "Uniform guy on the scene recognized her. Knew her from the hospital. Everybody knew Nina." I shut my eyes, but I saw Nina Child's face, and I opened them again. She had been the 11-7 charge nurse in the ER unit at St. Anthony's Hospital, where once I'd run like a tornado with a dying little boy in my arms. Samson and I had worked with Nina more times than I could remember. Samson had also dated Nina for over a year, but then they'd broken it off. She married a neighborhood man who worked for the city. They had two kids, two little babies, and Nina had seemed so happy the last time I saw her. I couldn't believe she was lying dead in a tenement cellar on the wrong side of the Anacostia. She had been abandoned, like one of the Jane Does. Nina Child's body had been found in a battered row house in one of the city's most impoverished, destroyed, and dismaying neighborhoods. There was only one patrol car on the scene, and a single rusted and dented EMS van. Homicides in Southeast don't attract much attention. A dog was barking somewhere, and it was the only sound on that desolate street. Samson and I had to walk past an open-air drug mart on the corner of 18th Street. Mostly young males, but a few children and two women were also gathered there defiantly. The drug marts are everywhere in this part of Southeast. The neighborhood youth activity is the crack trade. Samson and I walked across 18th, then into the boarded-up three-story row house straight ahead. A black-and-white boxer leaned out of a third-floor window, like a lifetime resident, and wouldn't stop barking. Otherwise, the building seemed deserted. The front door had been jimmied 100 times, so it just swung open for us. The building smelled of fire, garbage, water damage. There was a gaping hole in the ceiling from a burst steam pipe. It was so wrong for Nina to have ended up in this sad, abominable place. For over a year, I have been unofficially investigating unsolved murders in Southeast, many of them Jane Doe's. My count was well over 100, but no one else in the department was willing to agree to that number, or anything close to it. Several of the murdered women were drug abusers or prostitutes, but not Nina. We carefully descended a circular stairwell that had a shaky, well-worn wooden railing that neither of us would touch. I could see flashlights shining up ahead, and I already had my maglight turned on. Nina was deep in the basement of the abandoned building. At least somebody had bothered to tape off the perimeter to protect the crime scene. There were dead flowers on the floor near the body. I focused on the flowers, still not able to look at Nina again. It didn't fit with the other Jane Doe's, but the killer didn't have a strict pattern. That was one of the problems I was having. It might mean that his fantasy was still evolving, and that he hadn't finished making up his gruesome story yet. I noted shreds of foil and cellophane wrappers lying everywhere on the floor. Rats are attracted to shiny things and often bring them back to their nests. Thick cobwebs weaved from one end of the basement to the other. "I'm Detective Alex Cross. Let me take a look at her, please," I finally said to the EMS team, a man and a woman in their 20s. "I'll just be a couple of minutes, then I'll get out of your way." "The other detectives already released the body," the male EMS worker said. He was rail thin, with long, dirty blonde hair. He didn't bother to look up at me. "Let us finish our job and get the hell out of this cesspool. Whole area is highly infectious, smells like shit." "Just back away," Samson barked. "Get up before I pull your skinny ass up." The EMS techie cursed, but he stood and backed away from Nina's body. I moved in close, tried to concentrate and be professional, tried to remember specific details I had gathered about the previous Jane Doe's in Southeast. I was looking for some connection. I wondered if a single predator could possibly be killing so many people. If that was the case, then this would be one of the most savage killing sprees ever. I took a deep breath, and then I knelt over Nina. The rats had been at her, I could see, but the killer had done much worse damage. It looked to me as if Nina had been beaten to death, with punches and possibly kicks. She might have been struck 100 times or more. I was at the homicide scene for a little over 2 hours, much longer than I wanted to be there, and I hated every second. I couldn't fix a set pattern for the Jane Doe killings, and Nina Child's murder didn't help. Why had he struck her so many times, and so savagely? What were the flowers doing there? Could this be the work of the same killer? The way I usually operate at a crime scene is to let the homicide investigation take on an almost aerial view. Everything emanates from the body. Samson and I walked the entire crime scene, from the basement to each floor, and up onto the roof. Then we walked the neighborhood. Nobody had seen anything unusual, which didn't surprise either of us. I sensed I was at the start of another homicide mess. I didn't want it, but I couldn't stop the horror. I had to try to do something about the Jane Doe's. I just couldn't stand by and do nothing. Although I was assigned to the 7th District as a senior detective, my job as liaison with the FBI gave me some extra status and also the freedom to occasionally work without too much supervision or interference. My mind was running free, and I had already made some associations between Nina's murder and at least some of the unsolved killings. First, there had been no identification on the victims at each crime scene. Second, the bodies had frequently been dumped in buildings where they might not be found quickly. Third, not a single witness had seen anyone who might be a suspect. The most we ever got